So thank you for joining us for this Q&A following the performance, which hopefully you very much enjoyed. My name is Tim Rushby. I'm the head of marketing here at Lakeside. On my right, from the University of Nottingham, I've got Professor Gerardo Adesso from the School of Mathematical Sciences and Professor Mark Fromhold from the Faculty of Science. And on my left, from formerly the Royal Birmingham Conservatoire, were you still there, or you finished? So, but from it finished the opera anyway. We've got Roxanne Korda, who was an incredibly intimidating entropy this evening, and Daniel Blanco Albert, who is this evening's conductor and composer. So I'll open this up to the floor at this point and ask if anybody has a question to kick us off. Anyone at all? Yes, over here. Thank you. Well, we do have, just hold on, we do have a roving mic just to save vocal cords.
It's not a scientific question, I'm afraid. I love the set design. I see that, I thought the inflatable was ingenious. I wondered if you'd like to talk a little bit about how it all happened.
Yeah, with the inflatable, we worked with a professor from BCU, Birmingham City University, who's a specialist on those inflatables. And we had a module on her undergraduate course that she ran, where they created lots of different inflatables for us with different universe-inspired shapes. And they were great, but they just weren't practical for the stage, unfortunately. But that one was, which was great. So yeah, that's where it came from. And yeah, it was always really, it's really fun performing inside it. Although I'm not really sure what it looks like from the outside. So.
Well, about the rest of the set design, we just designed the ourselves. So we were just we really wanted a black hole on stage. So I mean, I don't know if any other production has ever had a black hole, a whole black hole, and kind of scientifically accurate a black hole, more or less, I would say.
Yeah.
well, if it was a scientific library, we would be just all inside there right now, probably. And then the other kind of the ghost things, it was we wanted to create this kind of a time ghost, like an hourglass, also with the strings in the top. But we had to modify it a bit. But still, there's all this reference to the entanglement within the ropes and the material.
Also, the backdrop was painted by Henry Korda, and he also provided the clock. And we have the ladder, which was supposed to represent lambda, which is the cosmological constant. So, I don't know if I've got that. Yeah, and there's the office at the back, which is where entropy sits, like ruling over the universe and doing its work and making sure that destruction does occur. And from time to time, paints more madness on its backdrop, or clock to make sure time is passing.
Well, and also this kind of chaos with the hourglass is as you could see, they were like a kind of we used them for to represent the parallel universes because with the ghosts and everything projecting on it, and also having the lights could create this kind of atmosphere to create this kind of parallel universes inside the black hole.
So thank you very much for that. Do we have any more questions for our panel this evening? Yeah, here, just at the front. Have we got?
I think it's okay.
Okay.
I'm loud enough without my microphone. Why does the quarks or the quantum particles have such silly names? Like top and bottom and up and down and strange and charged?
It is, but I just want to expand on that. They kept getting called out by entropy at various points as well. So a part B to that question is, I'd just be intrigued as to why that was happening.
Well, I guess it's partly an example of physicist's sense of humour. You know, you've got to do something when you're sitting in the dark all day, and the top bottom charm, I guess, would be what you'd think of. Top and bottom, I guess, are indicative of some sort of spin. So I think it's partly just a humour thing on the part of the people that were developing those names, at least to my knowledge. Any thoughts?
Yeah. I think at some point there were more properties that people imagined, and then they just ran out of sensible names.
because you can tell from time to time, or it can tell from time to time, to vent some anger, to get something to happen. So we were just using them as that, really. Because Entropy doesn't really have anyone to talk to. It's quite lonely.
Imaginary friends.
Yeah, imaginary friends. Thank you.
Do we have any more questions? Oh, just here. Yes, sir.
Hi. I am a non-scientist, as will become clear from my question. The thing that intrigues me, I'm coming from a point of view where we are able to observe all this and conduct these investigations because, as an accident of the universe, we have evolved consciousness and the ability to do that. When it comes to talk of parallel universes, what I'd like some clarification on is whether, when we talk about parallel universes, we are talking about theoretical constructs or actualities, and given that actualities is a difficult term in this context, are they actualities that could be observed if a consciousness had evolved in them, or are they actually theoretical constructs which we have developed in the universe we live in order to make sense of what is going on? Sorry, does that question make sense?
It doesn't entirely to me, but I'm sure it might do someone on my right. Who would like to field that?
Okay, so the theory of many worlds or parallel universes deals with one of the possible interpretations of quantum mechanics. So we have a problem, we still don't understand in quantum mechanics, it's been more than 100 years, is what happens when we actually observe something. Normally we have a system described by a quantum state which evolves according to an equation. This equation is perfectly reversible, describes the dynamics which can go back and forth in time. So, but when you make a measurement, then so-called quantum state collapses, and so even if a system is in a superposition, it actually ends up in a specific value. So this particular thing, it works, it's compatible with experiments, but we don't understand it. So there are various ways to try to interpret this. One theory says that actually there's no collapse, but every time we measure something, every possible outcome happens, and just the universe branches out into multiple universes where each of these particular things are happening. Now your question is very sensible. I think for the last century there's been a lot of debate whether discussion about foundations correspond to some verifiable predictions in experiments. I think there's been some progress recently. There was a paper by, well, I don't want to get technical, it's a paper by researchers in Zurich where they try to argue that actually the many worlds interpretation of quantum mechanics is probably the only consistent one, given some hypotheses on which we can debate or not. So we are reaching a point where we could probably design an experiment where we would be able to see if, say, quantum state as an element of reality, whether the interpretation corresponding to many worlds is correct or not. We are not yet at that point. But there's been progress towards designing some kind of experiment. If you're more curious about alternative interpretations, get this booklet outside, because this is describing them. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, I guess the complexity is that whenever any measurement's made, if the theory is valid, it would mean that there's another universe born. And so if you think throughout all of time of all of the measurements that have been made, there'll be so many universes, there are all sorts of questions like, where would the energy come from, for example? So it's conceptually very hard to see how every time you make a measurement, another universe is born, for me at least. Of course, the good news is that in one world, if your cat's died, in another one, it's still alive. So we can hope it's true. Maybe,
is there anyone there to feed
it? Well, it's some universe, I don't think. That could hope it's the same universe, I think.
Thank you. Do we have any more questions? Yes, the gentleman, the
I think that'll be okay. At the moment, I'm learning lots and lots of quantum mechanics in my history. And one thing I've noticed is that we really see throughout time lots of key stages of both theoretical development and experimental development in the entire field. Do you know now where it's kind of going? It's kind of like where the quantum theory is going, and also in practice. Does that make sense?
Well, we can guess where it's going. But it's always a guess. And often people will say, well, a key development could be quantum computers. But they're often 5 years in the future. So, you know, the kind of guess time scale is 5 years. We do know, and you've probably seen, that you can use things like entanglement now to improve the measurements of magnetic fields, for example, for brain imaging, so you can, at room temperature, entangle around 100,000 atoms and use that for a real measurement that can be telling you more about how your brain's functioning, for example. So for me, that's an extremely exciting direction, the fact that you can now use this physics. Actually, while we were thinking about electrons and positrons and them annihilating, and I was getting tense because I kind of knew that this wasn't going to end happily, I was thinking about the lights, and actually all these blue lights, these LEDs, are exactly analogous to that. So you've got an electron in there, in the structure emitting that light, and a positron, which is a hole, and they're constantly recombining and annihilating and giving out that blue light, which is exactly the same as the balloon. So it kind of struck me that this very, very abstract concept is around us all the time. I mean, the some quantum mechanics is here. And so I think there's a huge amount of excitement in parallel developments of applications and very fundamental theory. You know, if you can make more measurements on a black hole, probably you can understand how quantum mechanics and gravity come together, perhaps over the next few decades. In fact, I was talking to somebody in the department this morning, Claire Burridge, who works on black holes, and asking her what's the key topic, and that was what she thought was going to keep her busy for the next while, until retirement, actually, if she ever retires.
Thank you. I'm sure our technical team here will be delighted to know that their lighting directly tied into the physics for this evening. Roxanne, can I just ask you a question about, I think I'm right in saying that this opera began with your libretto, is that correct? And I just want to, what initially sort of spurred you on to develop an opera around such a complicated topic, complicated subject?
It's just been a subject that I've thought about a lot, so to me it seemed the most natural thing to write a story about. That's really it. It's a way of combining science with philosophy and bringing it into a forum that enables you to make it really human and emotional, rather than like what physics normally is, or what physics has been generally in my experience studying it. So yeah, I just came to the point where I thought about things so much that in my head it was like, oh, there's a story there. So that's kind of what happened. Yeah.
Fine. Do we have any other questions from the room? Yes.
Because you were just mentioning the libretto. Were there many things which didn't make it into the final cut?
There were some things. Yeah, we had a whole scene that. So to get the positron into the future, which ended up being a bit of a leap of faith. With the gravitational wave, but it was initially going to be a scene about retrocausation, and they would be sort of flipping around in different parts of time, space-time, and affecting each other, and eventually managed to work their way back to each other in the same point. But it was just too complicated in the end, so we scrapped that and just went surfing on a wave.
The best thing is that the way we were thinking for that scene was just, okay, how can we relate the kind of time traveling with music? And we were discussing, oh, we can just maybe do some kind of pastiche music, like a kind of music for the Baroque, music from the classicism, from this kind of different time periods. But then we were just thinking a bit more, and we just said, okay, what's the chance that in all the million of years, all these kind of time changes that just happen in 400 years or even less. So it's like a kind of it didn't really make sense at all. So we just did it as well. That was one of the reasons.
Yeah, I was trying to think, oh, what would the dinosaur music sound like? Yeah, probably not a good thought.
Thank you. Do we have maybe, probably got time for a couple more questions if anyone's got them. Yes, right at the back of the room there, if you want to get the microphone.
Perhaps
perhaps you could organise this as a show of hands. I'm quite interested in the audience itself. So we've got the session now where we've got quantum professors, academics, talking about an opera. So it's interesting how the arts and the sciences have come together. And it's quite a young audience, like I come to quite a lot of classical music here, and this is a young audience compared to what I'm normally
It is, doing. Yes.
So I'm just interested, is the audience, are they musical? Are they actually more on the sciences? What has driven people to come here? Or are people
should we just should we do a wonderfully scientific survey here? So who are here, who studies physics, or associated with physics, or a similar topic here at the university? Does anyone have any connection to our music department here at the university, or perhaps plays in the orchestra or anything
no
like that?
No way.
I find that fascinating. That's
And who here has absolutely no connection to the university whatsoever? There you are. Does that answer your question?
Time's
awesome. Yeah,
what you okay. Yes, absolutely.
Who here hasn't ever seen an opera?
Or did you like the format? It's like no.
Thank you. And one last question. Oh, right at the back here.
Oh, right. I studied music. No, I'm not a pure science. I just wondering, the music, the notes, were there any like horse tones or anything being used? Or was it just normal harmonies? And what kind of scale? Were there any particular scales?
There were a few at the very beginning, but the things like we're using them like as part of as dramatic effect. But the things that the music has a kind of scientific journey as well. So it accompanies the travel of entropy, the story of entropy. So we start with a kind of with 12 notes at the very beginning. We actually start with one. It's like a kind of a joke. Then entropy gets angry, and she touches that note forever. So that note, that first note that you heard at the very beginning of the opera, that's not used anymore during the whole opera. So from there, we have the 11 notes that they are kind of disappearing and they're being taken by entropy until the very end, which there's only one note at the very, very end of the universe. And then the last chord, the weird chord at the very end, is actually a metaphor of the equal distribution.
Yeah, it's like the heat.
That's all the matter is kind of
the
end.
It was E that went at the beginning.
Yeah.
And for those of us who don't have perfect pitch, what note was it? It was the left at the end.
It was C. Yeah. There's
a
reason for the order.
Oh, yeah. The reason for the to the order is just some kind of series created with pi number. So pi number just determined the notes that they were disappearing at the end. And actually, it's quite cool. It's actually quite atmospheric.
Brilliant, thank you very much. I think we'll bring it to a close at that point.